Good morning, everybody. I need the announcements up.
Oh, I've got it.
You're trying?
I am trying.
Well, let's get started.
Uh-oh, what happened?
I don't know. I tore it up, too.
There you go.
Okay.
It's slow down.
All right. Let's go through some announcements this morning. Lots of things going on in the month of August. There's a ride coming up for breast cancer. That'll be coming up in August. The posting will be up there, and it's also on our group page. There's several rides that are going on throughout the month. We're also planning in the fall to do a series on spiritual warfare. We're going to do a series of sermons, and then we'll create a Bible study that occurs between each sermon as well. And we'll be using a book called Putting on the Armor. It's written by the guy that was the evangelism director for Billy Graham Association. So that's the plan that we have at this point. We haven't figured out a day to start. We haven't figured out when we're going to start doing it, but that'll be coming in the fall. I'll keep you updated as we get things doing. What I will do over the next couple of weeks is start to ask people that are interested so that we can buy the books. We know how many to purchase. Hey, Roger.
Hi. A little slow come in. Let me check that shot.
The Fabulous 50 ride is August 24th. That starts at Main Street Station. It is a prelude to the 100, and what it does is it raises money to do the advertising for the Freedom 100 ride. And so it's really good. It's a good one to attend. We went to it a couple years. In fact, the folks that I did the wedding for yesterday, Lee and Vicky, that's where we met them, was at the Fabulous 50 ride. So, and they're going to be moving back to the area, so they'll be coming back to church also. So, it's a really good group of folks. You will appreciate what they do. All of the money they raise for the Freedom 100 goes to veterans organizations. So, it's really worth. How come that's not moving? Okay, Wednesday's Ride to Nowhere. Chuck Bohm's continuing that ride every Wednesday night. If you're interested, all you got to do is get on to the All Riders group page. And he kind of puts out there when he's going to start and where it's going to go. Usually rides around anywhere between 70 and 90 miles. They usually leave about 6:30 out at the land. And then they get back there, and folks are home usually by about 9 o'clock. Band show concerts are still going on. Night Train, Guns N' Roses next week. That went really fast. How come that one went really fast?
Because I'm messing with you.
And then next Saturday is Kiss America, and they are really phenomenal. So if you're interested, probably some of us will go to that again next week. That's always a fun time. There will be another full moon ride August the 15th.
That was a lot of
fun, and Dan is talking about doing another full moon ride. This time, he's planning to go, from what he told me when I talked to him the other day, was he's planning to go north this time, up toward Flagler and Ormond in that direction this time. So, but he picked some really good roads. I told him, whatever he does, we do not want to hit Mosquito Lagoon.
That was boring, wasn't it?
At 10 o'clock at night, it was pretty brutal. So I told him wherever he goes, we need to go less mosquitoes. But it's August the 15th. That ride started at 6:30.
By the loop.
Down there at 6:30.
We left there. 7:45.
7:45. It started at 7:45, and we left here at 6:30 to go meet those guys. So, but that's a fun ride. November is another bat ride. If you want to go to Milwaukee, there's one up there next week for bat. So there's a lot of stuff going on. Prayer requests, I know of some. Bobby sent one this morning. I don't recall the relationship, but it's... High school friend who was on the transplant list for heart. Is it heart?
Yeah.
And they can't do it because of some serious medical side effects. So I think his name is Scott.
Yes.
We'll keep him in prayer. Judy Skeens, if you've seen her on our group page, she also attends our service a lot on Sunday morning from New Jersey. Her father-in-law passed away. She got a hold of me this morning and asked that we keep her and her husband George in prayer. There were some other prayer requests too, but I can't remember. Other prayer requests? I know you've got some friends and we need to keep them in prayer.
The Barron family.
Okay.
The Bartlesons.
Bartlesons?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Other prayer requests?
They talked to people that did that to us, so I'm very happy that we need prayer.
Good.
To find his statement.
Good. We are preparing to go to Tennessee in August, so keep us in prayer as we get ready. Luckily, the other day when we were riding on the full moon, and I looked down and saw that my front tire is bad, so I need to put a front tire on my bike, which I was glad I saw. It just happened to be in the right way at the light for me to be able to see that it was coming. So I've got that on. Anything else? Okay, well, let's go to the Lord in prayer and then we can start.
Now, I just wanted to give you a heads up, Jim. I had paid for our cabin at Iron Horse, and so they took a couple $100 deposit, and like 2 weeks later, they charged my card for the balance. And I called, and I said, hey, what's going on with this? Was this charged by mistake? And the lady informed me, no, that's the new owner's policy. They want our payment in full 60 days in advance of your stay.
Wow.
So everybody that's going, just check your payment method and make sure that everything's accurate.
Yeah. And you still have to find out whether you have a place.
Well, I paid for it. I just haven't done it.
You're not sleeping in the camper with Barb and I. I just want you to know that.
We'll let you sleep by the creek by our cabin.
We can put you under the cover at the back of the truck.
Well, I can sleep on top of the trail. I don't care. Starry night.
Poor Roger.
We're tent.
I paid for it. They just haven't sent me my
confirmation.
I paid for it.
If worse comes to worse, we'll put your tent on the back of the truck.
You can always sleep on our porch.
No, we can't.
Hey, I want to be a porch rat. Yeah. Or is that what do you call it? A political thing?
All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Lord, thank you for your love and your grace and your mercy and for the purposes that you have for us. Lord, you know that there are a lot of needs that we have this morning. There's things that we need to be aware of. Folks that are hurting, the Barron family and Scott, keep them in your sights and in your arms. Lord, we know that they have needs that only you can provide for. And Lord, we know that there are some folks that have illnesses, and we just ask that you continue to keep the Bartlesons in prayer as they continue to work through the issues that are going on with them, and keep Mike and Don in prayer. Lord, we just ask that we know that there are things that only you can do for us, and we need to open our hearts to you in all ways. Thank you again for your love. Thank you for your mercy. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Stand with me.
Of sin and darkness, whose love is mine?
seated. Why don't y'all come up while you're getting ready? I forgot this morning, Miranda, who has been a part of us, her and her husband Kyle, texted this morning, said that Kyle was pretty sick this week, so they're going to be home watching. But she also has some personal needs that she's asked us to pray for. So let's bow our heads real quick and have a prayer for her as well. Lord, thank you for this love that you give us and for all that you do. And Lord, we just ask that you reach down and heal Kyle and help Miranda and Kyle's hearts. Lord, we know there are things that they need that only you can take care of. Thank you for your love. Thank you for the time to be here. We ask that you bring them back safely to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. That we got a big crowd of folks here today.
Yep.
That'd be good. You know, I got that camera, I don't know, but it used to look like when they had it back yonder, it looked like there wasn't nobody here, but everybody be sitting in the back. And amen calling up here, there wouldn't be nobody up there. So anyway, y'all look good back there. At least all the women do it. I don't know about
I'll say the men look good.
Yeah, well, got the love of everybody. You know, okay, here's a song called He's All Right. Yo. Sing along. I don't think she does that except he's all right. So.
Yeah, y'all just sing he's all right.
God is so alright. bodies are all right with me.
Because I would wait till after the sermon and decide if it's worth doing anything. This morning we are in Luke 13 chapter, and I think it's page 489 in the White Bibles, and I don't know what it is on your iPhone. You'll have to figure that one out yourself, but we're going to be in Luke the 10th chapter this morning. And, there's all those songs that we hear about, Blessed Be the Tie That Binds. And this morning I want to talk about, oh, those ties that bind. And the things that keep us locked up and tied up and away from where we need to be. So this morning we're going to be in Luke 13, about 10, starting at verse 10. And we're going to read down through verse 17. And then we'll kind of dig into this. Now he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath. And behold, there was a woman who had a disabling spirit for 18 years. I didn't put it in there, did I? She was bent over and could not fully straighten herself. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and said to her, "Woman, you are freed from your disability." And he laid his hands on her, and immediately she was made straight, and she glorified God. But the ruler of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had healed on the Sabbath, and said to the people, "There are 6 days in which work ought to be done. Come on those days and be healed, and not on the Sabbath day." This down just a tinge. Then the Lord answered him, "You hypocrites, does not each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or his donkey from the manger and lead it away to water? And not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan bound for 18 years, be loosed from this bond on the Sabbath day? And he said these things. All his adversaries were put to shame, and all the people rejoiced at all the glorious things that were done by him. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Lord, we come before you this morning to dig into your word and understand those things that you want for us to do. Lord, we know that there is nothing in us that we want to interfere with your desires in our lives, and we just ask that you open us up and allow us to become that person you choose for us to be. Thank you for this time together. Thank you for this morning. Thank you for the opportunity to come and worship you in this great country. In Jesus' name, amen. In this passage, Christ is in the synagogue teaching. This is extremely unusual. If you look at all of the New Testament, very rarely does Jesus walk into the synagogue and into the church. Most of the time that he is in ministry, he is either in somebody's home, or he is out in the street, or he is out in a town. But he is out where the people need to be ministered to. And it just so happens that this particular day, he's in the synagogue. And this woman comes in who is bent and broken. And she walks in, and he says to her, he says, "What woman, what's wrong with you?" And I in my mind, you know, the word that is used here is asthenia. That's the Greek word. And it means feeble or broken. We don't know what broke this woman. We don't know whether it was something spiritual, something that occurred at birth. We don't know if it's an accident. We don't know if it's an injury. We don't know if she is just so beaten down by life that she is just unable to look up. We don't know what really caused this. But we know that she comes into the temple, the place where she ought to get the most love and care. And in reality, the only person in this whole building that pays attention to her is Jesus. And all of us, when we get broken and we get beaten down, we get feeble, and we struggle to figure out what's going on in the world around us, sometimes we go to places to get healing and it doesn't happen. The scripture talks about in this passage, she was bent this way for 18 years. The symbolic period of 18 years goes back to Judges, which is when the Israelite nation went into exile with several different kingdoms prior to Saul being named king. And so in reality, for Israel and for this woman, it wasn't just 18 years, it was eternity. It was this feeling, this is never going to end. I am going to be this way forever. And I can see this woman bent over and trying to get through life and trying to understand what's going on. You know, if we look deep in our hearts and deep into our own souls as Christ followers, we know that truly the hardest things that we face bend us. They keep us bent over. They keep us looking down. They keep us not being able to look up to see the kingdom that God has designed for us. You know, this world is it's easy to get beat up. It's easy to feel like something is wrong. It's easy to feel like the world is going to just tear us apart. And Satan's purpose is really simple. If I keep you looking down, you will never look up to the King that can make you feel better. When I was in rehab, 5 years ago, August the 12th, I had a motorcycle accident. I broke 17 bones. I broke 9 ribs all down one side, 8 vertebrae. I'm actually 2 inches shorter. I'm one of those people that can truly say I didn't gain weight. I just got shorter. But I spent 10 days in ICU and a month in rehab. And I remember the whole time that I was in rehab and they were trying to teach me how to walk, they kept telling me, quit looking down, look up. Quit watching your feet and look ahead of you. And I was using a walker. And I remember, can you go to the next slide? Next one. Next one. Next one. You've not been paying attention.
Norm.
I was in a walker. And every time I would go to walk, this guy would lift my chin and say, quit looking down. You're going to get hurt because you're looking down. If you look up, you'll see where things are at. In a couple of weeks, we're going to be going to the Tail of the Dragon. And anybody that's taken the motorcycle course knows that when they teach you to ride a motorcycle, they don't tell you to watch the front wheel. They tell you to look out ahead of you. If you're looking directly in front of you, you're going to go down. And when you're on the tail, you have to look up because you have to see where the turns are. You have to see what direction you're going. You have to see the road, and you have to see somebody that's crossed over and is likely to hit you. And God says to us, quit looking down. Quit looking down at this world. Quit looking down at the things that beat you up. Quit looking down at the things that have destroyed your life. Quit looking down at the injuries that you have and look up, because I am the King and I have a kingdom for you outside of this world. Paul wrote in 2 Timothy, remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, the offspring of David, as preached in my gospel, for which I am suffering bound with chains as a criminal. But the word of God is not bound. This morning, as we look into our hearts, we can see those things that keep us bound, bent, and looking away from what God wants us to see. There was a tightrope walker, great tightrope walker over in Europe, and he had walked across this huge falls over there. And there was a promoter that said, sent him a message that said, can you really do that? And he said, yes. He said, well, would you be willing to come over to the States and do that over Niagara Falls? And the guy said, yes. The guy said, well, I'm not sure I believe you can do it. And the tightrope walker said, I can walk across the falls. And so after several months of promotion, they bring him over from Europe. And the promoter sets it up, and there's thousands of people. And the guy walks across a tightrope over Niagara Falls with no trouble. And then he turns around and he walks back. And when he gets back to the other side, he picks up a wheelbarrow and he starts walking across the tightrope again, pushing a wheelbarrow. And he gets to the other side and he gets down off the tightrope and he looks at the promoter and says, now do you believe that I can walk across Niagara Falls on a tightrope? The guy said, yes, I saw you do it. He said, are you sure you believe that I can do it? And the promoter said, absolutely. And the tightrope walker said, are you absolutely sure I can do it? And the promoter said, yes. He said, then get in the wheelbarrow. We have to come to some decisions. The word believe in Greek means to live by. It sounds like a really nice story and fun to hear about the wheelbarrow. But how many times do we say to God, help me out? But I'm not sure you can do it. Help me out of whatever's going on. but I'm not willing to get in the wheelbarrow. There's a Haitian pastor who told the story of a guy that had a house. And he was selling it for $2,000. And the guy said, and the man wanted to buy the house. He said, I can't afford $2,000. I'll give you $1,000. And after a lot of haggling, the guy said, I'll sell you the house for $1,000 on one condition. I get to keep possession of that single nail hanging over the door. The guy says, okay. A couple years later, the guy comes back and says, I want to buy the house back. The guy says, I'm not selling you this house. I bought it for $1,000. It's my house. The guy said, okay. So he went out and found a dead dog and hung it on the nail in the front of the door. And the longer it stayed there, the more uninhabitable the house became. Until eventually the man sold the house back to the original owner. If we don't remove the dead dogs in our lives, it's easy for Satan to get a hold and pull us back where we used to be. And so when we buy the house that God has given us by our faith in Him, we ought not to be willing to give up that single nail. We ought not to be willing to give up that single thing that ties us back to Satan. First of all, we need to release the past hurts that bind us. Psalm 71:20 says, you have made me so many troubles and calamities will revive me again. For the depths of the earth, you will bring me up again. God says, if you will just let me in, I will create for you a kingdom. But you got to give it all up. You don't get to hang on to that one thing that keeps you there. And sometimes that's hurt. It could be hurt from relationships. It could be hurt from a person. It could be hurt from past experiences and how we grew up. It could be life. But if we let that hurt hang on in our heart, we let the whole house start to stink up. Psychologist Leigh Craig told the story of when he was a kid, he went into the bathroom and he closed the door and locked it, and then he couldn't get out. And he stood in there forever. And he began crying and screaming, and his mom went up to the door and she couldn't get the door open. And his dad came up and he couldn't get the door open. And finally, the dad went around the back and got a ladder and put it up and went in the back window. And he walked in and he unlocked the door. And the little boy ran out and began to play in the yard. And he tells this story because our relationship with God, sometimes we cry out, we say, God, help us, God, help us. And we expect Him to come in the window and open the door and let us out. And sometimes He comes in the window and He sits down on the floor and says, sit with me. Let me heal the fear that you have. Let me heal the heart that has kept you bound and locked away. You know, sometimes I struggle myself. Something bad happens and I pray, God, I need you to fix this. And sometimes God comes in and just says, let me sit with you. Let me sit with you. Sometimes we think our troubles and our fears and our problems, God ought to just fix. And sometimes God doesn't just fix them. He tries to teach us how to fix them ourselves with His guidance and His direction. Sometimes He just climbs in that small window behind our mind. and sits down on the floor and says, "Come sit with me. We may scream, 'Get me out of here,' but he says, 'Come sit with me. I will help you get out.'" You know, glorifying God isn't what God does for us, it's what we do for God. Releasing past hurts and pain comes in recognizing His desires and learning to accept His desires in our lives is what glorifies God. That's how we escape the pains of the day. That's how we escape the locked doors. Hearing Him and how He wants us to move. Secondly, we need to release the habitual sins that keep us focused on this world. Revelation 12:9 says, "And the great dragon was thrown down, that ancient serpent who is called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the whole world. He is thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him." We have sometimes that habitual sin. And every week we say, "God, forgive me for it." And yet we hang on to that habitual sin. Scripture tells us that Satan is the prince of this world. That's very clear. And Satan doesn't look like the devil with horns and a pointed tail. He was an angel. He was beautiful. Ron thinks all the women look good. Diane, thank you for telling us the men look good. But Satan doesn't look like a bad thing. It looks like a great thing. You know, upon entering the country store, a guy comes in and he sees a sign that says, "Beware the dog." And he looks around and he sees this old hound dog laying on the floor. And he starts to chuckle to himself. And he says to the owner of the store, "Is that the dog I'm supposed to beware of?" He said, "Yeah." He said, "Well, that dog doesn't look like he would hurt anybody." He said, "Oh, he won't. But I had to put that sign up because people kept tripping over him." It's not those big sins. Those habitual sins aren't the big ones that we do. It's the little ones that we do that keep us tied in a way from recognizing God in our lives. It's not the vicious pit bull. It's the hound dog laying there that when you fall over, you're still going to break your leg just as badly as if you were running away from one. My father used to tell the story when he was a kid. He used to, he chuckled about this a lot. He used to trap skunks back when he was a kid, back in the 40s and 50s. And he used to laugh about it because I said, "Well, what did you do with skunk pelts?" He said, "Well, I used to sell them to the guys in New York City. They'd make coats out of them and tell people they were mink." But he used to tell this story about there was a lot of times that he would walk up on a trap and kind of forget what he was doing. And the skunk would be caught in the trap, but not really dead. And he said, you don't know how many times he went to school stinking like skunk. Because he used to run his trap line early in the morning. And so he got in the habit of carrying a long pole with him. So that when he'd come up close to the skunk trap, he'd reach out and poke the skunk first to see if the skunk was still alive. And from that experience, he learned that a lot of times the trap didn't kill the skunk. Some of those sins that we get caught up in, they're not really dead. We might have caught them in a trap of prayer. We might have caught them in a trap with somebody else. We might have caught them in a trap of Bible studies. But we've never eliminated that small habitual thing that gets in the way. We need to release the fears that keep us from looking up and keep us looking down. After the accident, I could not walk well, obviously. And I could probably, at the time that picture was taken, probably only walk about 50 steps. And I remember, as they were telling me to look up, I was looking down because for some reason I thought if I could see my feet, I would be okay. And the problem with that is I was so busy looking at my feet, I missed things. Anybody ever had the same experience? Like you're walking down the hallway of someplace, and all of a sudden you trip, and you turn around and look at the floor like you did something wrong? First Kings 17:8-9 says, then the word of the Lord came to him, wise go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded a widow there to feed you. Elijah was facing a basic need crisis in this passage. The water in the creek where he lived had run out. Food was scarce. And God came to him and said, I want you to go to Sidon. And Elijah was so afraid to go to Sidon because that's where all his enemies were. That's where everybody was that wanted to kill him. And God said, if you go there, there's a widow that will feed you and care for you and hide you. Now, she's not a believer like you, but I believe you can go there to minister to her. And so Elijah went. And he found that he was there not to get his own nourishment, but to give nourishment to the widow and her son, to minister to them. Elijah found out, like most of us, that when we can put our needs aside and look to where God wants us to be, there is a ministry that he has for us there. Luke 12:15 says, and he said to them, take care and be on your guard against all covetousness, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions, but in the will of God. It's not the riches. It's not the motorcycles. It's not the chrome. It's not the big houses or the cars. It's not the smokers, although that's really important to me. I gotta tell you. Smokers are a big deal to me. It's about where God puts you, there is a purpose. And there is a ministry that you can provide to somebody else, even when it feels like you're starving to death. Lastly, we need to release that part of us that says, I believe in my mind, but my heart is mine. Matthew 10:34 says, do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. There's a conflict that battles within us. There's a battle that occurs in our lives. And too often we believe in the intellectual part of who God is and forget that God calls us at the heart level. I believe that God wants us to do me to do this, but my heart is mine. And God says, when you are in, you are all in. Not just that mindful part of you. Satan was having a business meeting kind of like Steve Jobs and Apple. Mm-hmm. He stood up on the stage. He had a big whiteboard. And he said to the demons, tell me what we can do. We're losing people. They're getting to love what's going on in this world, and they're beginning to love God. What do we do? How do we get these people away from God and back to us? And one demon stands up and says, let's create a drug. We'll tell them it's not going to hurt them, but it'll slowly move them away from God. And another demon stands up and says, let's get scientists to tell them that there is no God. Scientists are really good at talking about the mind and how important that is. Satan says, man, that's a great idea. And he writes it up on the board. And the guy in the back, one of the demons says, let's tell them that Jesus was the Son of God. And if they believe on him, they'll be saved. And they'll be taken out of terrible things. And Satan says, are you out of your mind? Why would we tell them that? And the demon said, well, let's tell them all that, but tell them there's always tomorrow to accept him. There is no tomorrow. Scripture says at the point of the man wants to die, and after that, the judgment. We can't continue our lives saying we're going to live for Christ and not live for Christ. The story of Baron Munchausen is that he was on his way to... Baron Munchausen was a notorious liar. So he got on his horse and he headed toward town. And when he got to a mud pit, he got stuck in the mud. And he told people when he got to town, this is what happened. He said, I got stuck in the mud and I reached around and grabbed my ponytail and I pulled myself and the horse out of the mud trap. There is no saving ourselves. There is no getting to God on our own. There is no salvation that comes from our own purposes. Salvation only comes through Christ. We can't do it on our own. And when we try, we get caught up in those things that bind us up, bend us over, and keep us looking down and forgetting to look up to see the kingdom that God has built for us. This morning, as we look at ourselves, what are those things that keep us bent down? Is it those habitual sins? Is it that lack of faith? Is it that part of us that says, I believe, and we see a lot of people, I believe in God. There's going to be a lot of people in hell that believe in God. I believe in Jesus. So do the Muslims. They just don't believe that Jesus is the Savior of the world. There's a lot of people that believe who he was, but not what he is. And our prayer for people around us ought not to be that they know Christ, but that they learn to love Christ. That's the message. If we want to remove those things that tie us up in this world, then it's time to get down to business. It's time to get down to the bottom line. That passage says this. Now, I was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath, and behold, there was a woman who had a disabling spirit for 18 years. She was bent over, could not fully straighten herself up, and when Jesus saw her, he called her over and said to her, woman, you are free from your disability. that clear and direct. I believe firmly that God will free us from those disabilities. 5 years later, I have not had any surgery. Now, those of you that know me know I don't bend very well. I don't reach down to my toes easily. I don't often make it's not easy for me to tie my shoes. But 5 years later, I am walking, I am riding, and I am thankful that God brought me through. God can bring us through those things in our lives. He can remove those things that keep us bent and looking down if we will just realize it's all about Him and that we can't pull ourselves out of a mud pit by grabbing our own ponytail. Christ came to release us from the grip of Satan. He came to unbind our hearts and our minds. He came to allow us to move from being in bondage to being free. John 8:36 says, if the Son sets you free, you are indeed free. So where are we this morning? Are we unbound? Are we open? Are we aware? Let's bow for a word of prayer. Lord, thank you for your love. Thank you for the time to be here. Thank you for everything that you do for us. Thank you for the purposes that you have. And Lord, I just ask that you reach down in our hearts and help us to get out of that bondage that you put us in. Help us to straighten. Help us to figure out how to look up. Help us how to keep our eyes on you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Stand with me. let's circle up. Roger, you said something about going up to Flagler to a place that had ice cream.
Sally's. The other side of 100.
You have a place to eat up there, too?
You got Tortolgo's. You got Finn's.
Okay, well, let's go that way after church.
The other week. Plenty of food in Flagler.
Okay.
They like to eat in Flagler.
You go under the bridge, so...
We like Tortolgo.
They got one in
Pops. How are you?
Good, treasure.
Good. My name is Jennifer. John, nice to meet you.
That's right. Jerry, would you close this morning?
Bad hearing. Thank you, Father. I just thank you, Lord, for this time together. I praise your holy name, Lord, for what you've done here, speaking through Jim, and I pray that it would receive in our hearts and in our minds, and that we would use it for your glory, Father, this day. Protect us as we travel. Give us wisdom, Father. And help us to be a light for your glory and honor. I pray it in Jesus' precious name.
Amen. So you give us on keto already?
No. Nope. We're looking for keto friendly.
He's,
I don't know if they make keto friendly.
Pork chop ice cream.
Meat salad is keto friendly. Keto.
Oh, food one. Yeah. Well, see, I can't do it because I can't.
I'm not doing ice cream.
Huh? But we'll go.
But we'll go and watch y'all.